name is Furman Fordham. I am the senior pastor of Riverside here in Nashville. And we want to welcome you to our Riverside family and to our ministry. We are so happy that you have tuned in. Our prayer is that you will come to know God, grow in God, and sow God's love. We are praying that this presentation will be a blessing to you. And if you are ever in Nashville, we invite you to come worship with us. May God bless you, and we look forward to seeing you soon.
God is so worthy of our worship this day. He is so worthy of our praise. He's worthy of our adoration. God is so faithful. You know, it's amazing the thought that Jesus gave us everything. God gave us everything. You know, the word says that the commandment, the first and greatest commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, your mind, your soul, and with all your strength. This is the first and great commandment. And sometimes when God asks for everything, we're kind of looking like, Jesus, got little stuff hid away. But he's not asking from us anything that he was not willing to give us. He's not asking for anything that we weren't willing, that he was not willing to first do. The word says we don't love him because we were just that smart. We don't love him because, we just had it all together. No, we love him because he first loved us. God has called us to a reciprocal relationship. And so when he asked for it all, it's because he gave it all. And I promise you, y'all, his all is worth more than your all. His all is worth more than my all. And sometimes, you know, we get so caught up in the fact that he asked us for everything. But if Bill Gates asked you for your stuff in exchange for his, you would not hesitate. And Jesus' stuff is worth more than that. He gave us more than that. So when we say worship him, we don't have anything to hold back. So when he says to you, I want it all. Withholding nothing. Nothing. When I want to get to the heart of the matter, let me. When I want to go to where you are, when I want to come to your house, and open some closets. Let me. You don't have anything that's worth more than what I have to give. You got some stuff. And if it satisfies you, you wouldn't keep on running back to it. God is so good and he is so faithful. So today, let's just say yes. Yes. Get a yes in your spirit before I preach. Just get a yes in there. Just a yes, Lord. Because he's worth it. He is totally worth it. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus. Daddy, you are good. Your mercy, it does endure forever, oh God. And so, Lord, we thank you for being faithful. Lord, we thank you for being merciful. Father, we thank you for being able. God, for being capable to deal with us. Daddy, we thank you for being willing. Lord, that this was not a surprise to you. Oh, Daddy, you're willing. So thank you. And so right now, oh God, I ask that you make me a minister of your fire. Let us preach and prophesy with the fire of God. Father, Lord, I ask that you will burn in this place. Father, that you will burn in our hearts. And oh, Father, Lord, that we will be those Levites that you purify. Oh, Father, as silver and as gold, Lord, let us be tried by the fire. And let us come out pure. Let us come out refined. We thank you for it. We thank you. We love you. In the name of Jesus, amen and amen. I'm coming out of John 8. I want you all to catch this scene, though. Jesus is in the temple, right? And he's preaching. He's in the midst of teaching. Consider like a really good Bible class, you know, like one of our no classes that the whole church is participating in. So Jesus is in the courtyard, and he's teaching, and he's in mid-sentence when all of a sudden there is this gang of people that are rushing toward him. And in the midst of this gang of people, they throw this woman to his feet. This is in the middle of church, y'all. This is not like outside somewhere. No, this is in the middle of service. They decide to interrupt service. They're interrupting God's, Jesus' teaching, and they thrust her in the middle. And they say to him, hey, she's been stepping out on her man, Jesus. We caught her in the very act. Moses said she's worthy of death. What you think, Jesus? I want you to imagine the scene in the middle of church. And I don't want you to think about this woman. I want you to think about you. You know the stuff that nobody else knows. You know the stuff that we've been hiding, the stuff that we've been holding on to, we've been clinging on to, the stuff we cover up in our dresses and our suits. This is not her, this is you. And you get there, and in the midst, they tell Jesus, your pet sin. You are in the middle of church, and they start reading out your laundry list. The stuff your mama don't know about. The stuff your spouse may or may not know about. They begin to read out the list, and there you are at the feet of Jesus. See, let me tell you about church, okay? Now, your first time you come to church, if we know you a sinner, it's okay because it's your first time. You know what I mean? Like if you come to church and you've been in sin, you just got out of jail, you've been locked up, you got a whole bunch of kids with you, you got a few baby daddies, it's okay, because it's your first time. It's okay. We gonna love on you. Oh, you dealing with that? Oh, baby, it's okay. Come on, sit down next to me. Just as you are. That's it. That's it. And you come to church and you hear the word, you hear the gospel and how awesome it is. You make your way down. You pray with one of the prayer warriors. And they sit you down and Rashida hands you a card. And you fill out your name, you fill out everything, and you begin Bible studies. And you get into the, you find yourself a nice no class. And you find this great grow group. And you even go out with us on So Sabbath. And then you decide to get in the watery grave. And you come in and you get saved. You get delivered. And that is awesome, and we praise God with you, and we shout, and we thank God, and we talk about the grace for your past. And we point you to the hope for your future. But don't mess up after you've been saved. Now, I'm serious now. You know, you done buried that life, baby. You better not dig that thing back up. See, we've got grace for your past, and we've got hope for your future. Oh, but don't mess up now. Today, I want you to know that there's grace for today. There's grace for today. See, sometimes we find ourselves thrust in the midst, and the last person we want to be in front of is Jesus, because we know that our sins separate us from him. And we know that we're messed up. And the last thing we want to do is be in front of Jesus with the sheet on, with the stench of your lover on. We don't want to show up like that. Oh, no, let me get a shower first. Let me get the stench of last night off me. Let me put on a dress. Let me throw on some foundation. Let me put on a suit and tie. Let me look the part, even if I'm not living it. And so here you are in front of Jesus. And the whole world knows what you've done. And guess what? It's worthy of death. It's worthy of death. And here we are in front of Jesus, and we've got all these accusers. You know the people who they were good with you as long as you did it perfect. They were good with you. They knew you might have cheated a few people, but just don't cheat me. You may cross them, but don't cross me. I ain't that saved yet. And so you have these people, you've got this crowd, and you've been caught in the very act. And the way Jewish law works is the person, your witnesses, the witnesses to your sin get to cast the first stone. The ones who saw you do it, they get to cast the first stone. I know you messed up. I know you've done this, and I've seen you. I've seen you. I smell it. I know it. And since I saw you, since I caught you, I get to throw the first stone. The way stoning worked, it was wild, because they called the whole community to stone you. It wasn't just going to be a few people, because they didn't, the whole community did it, because if when you die, your blood wasn't going to be on anybody's hands, because my rock didn't kill you. Your rock alone didn't kill him. Oh, no, we're all going to do it. So we're all privy to this. And so here you have the person who witnesses it gets to throw the first stone. And so, you know, it could be your ex. It could be the one that you just got finished lying to. It could be the one that you cheated. It could be any myriad of women who you've been with in this church. It could be all kind of things. It could be anybody. They get to cast the first stone. And so they throw you at Jesus' feet. And I'm telling you, there's something that happens when you see somebody who is bruised and broken and sinful, and everybody knows about it. It's in those moments that we stand a little taller. And we feel a little better about ourselves because I did not do that. That's not who I am. That's not what I've done. That ain't nobody, can't nobody say that about me. And we start feeling a little better about me because I'm comparing myself to you. But the amazing thing about this story is Jesus was not comparing anybody to anybody other than the righteousness of God. And see, if I compare myself to you, see, the things that you've got issues with, I've already found victory. And so usually when I decide the standard of righteousness, it looks like me. When I decide what is good, I look at the things that I am doing right. And since I'm doing it right, I'm like, oh, you're doing it wrong. And so I become the standard of righteousness, the standard of God in my own eyes. And so when I look at what you've done, and you at Jesus' feet, and your laundry list. Whoo, your laundry list of offenses. The handwriting that is against you. I start feeling a little better about myself. Because I didn't do that. You did what to your husband? A word? You treat your wife like that? No wonder your kids don't want to come to church. I mean, we begin to go through this. And Jesus hears the accusations and he looks, he hears it all, and he just gets low. And he begins to write. It's almost like he was ignoring them, right? But, I mean, the people who he's ignoring, they're like, but Jesus. They don't sit there quietly and let him ignore them. No, they're in his face. Jesus, what you gonna do? Jesus, what do we do? Jesus, look at what they've done. How can they hold office in this church? Jesus, look at what they've done. What are you calling us to do? And so finally, Jesus knows the law, right? I already told you, the first person who throws a stone is the person who witnesses it. Jesus gets up, and he says, all right, whichever one of you is without sin, cast the first stone. You be the first. The first one who never got caught like this. You throw the stone. The first one who's never been in this situation. See, sometimes we've been in situations and we didn't get caught. And sometimes we've got these set of sins that if you do these are really, really bad. And then we've got a few acceptable ones. And so since I fall under the acceptable list, I'm all right. But I think the point that Jesus was trying to make is you all need grace for today. That's not to say that Jesus was looking at our sins and was like, oh, it's cool. No, he didn't say that. Jesus wasn't looking at it, and he wasn't denying the fact that she messed up. No, what Jesus was looking at, what he was saying is, you all need grace. Not just for your past. You need grace for today. And sometimes, you know, in the middle of the already and not yet, we sometimes forget how much we need today. And God is looking at us and he's saying, hey, I want you to know that you need me today. You can't go back on yesteryear. It takes grace for you to get your kids ready. It takes grace. No, y'all don't understand. I have to bind and rebuke to get my kids ready in the morning without yelling. No. Like before my feet hit the ground, I have to go and I have to start. Father, I just bind all confusion in the name of Jesus. Lord, I release peace in my house right now. Jesus, help us to get to school on time, Jesus. Father, I'm just asking for your presence, oh God. Lord, I release a spirit of obedience over my children right now. Oh God, give me peace of mind so I can deal with them this morning. Oh God, help us, Lord, not to be rushing. Help me not to be running around this house yelling. Oh God, please help me. No, that's what my morning starts like. Before my feet hit the ground. Because when I don't do, you know, that's what I need grace for. Baby, I need grace for today. And the crazy thing about it is, I'm sure this woman, I'm sure you and I'm sure the people in the, who her accusers, we have these moments where we know that we've messed up. But we think that we've got enough to fix it. We know that we haven't done everything quite right. But we think in our head, I can handle it. Let me tell y'all about my daughter, right? She did this yesterday. I promise you, I did not make this up. She's 2. Sweetest thing in the world. We're in the midst of potty training, right? And she's almost there, you know, she goes at daycare, she's doing great, you know. So I put her on a pull-up and panties, and they only put the pull-up on when she's about to take a nap. So she's doing real good, right? But yesterday, she gets home, and Daddy just said to her, Deja, do you have to go to the bathroom? And she said, no. Because she wanted to play a little. You know, don't you think, praise God for the Holy Ghost? Holy Ghost be coming to us. Holy Ghost be coming to us. Be like, Alicia, don't you think we should leave now? Bobby, don't you think we've had enough? Come on, let the Holy Ghost be trying to help us stay out of trouble, right? So Daddy comes to Deja and he says, Deja, you have to use the bathroom? No, because she wants to play, right? So the kids are playing or whatever. Baby and I, we go in our room, and we get a knock on the door. It's Isaiah, my oldest. He says, Mommy, Daddy, Deja doo-dooed in her diaper, and she got doo-doo everywhere. It's all on the carpet. It's on the floor. And she tried to take her diaper off, and we just got doo-doo. And the house stinks. Everywhere, okay? She needs some, right? For real, on the real, need some grace. Oh, glory. And so it's one of those moments where you just, woo-sah, help me, Jesus. And so it's like, she got doo-doo all over the bathroom. Okay, so I come out, and I go in the bathroom, and Deja's not in the bathroom. And I'm like, okay. Now I see a toilet full of toilet paper. I mean, it looks like she just, the whole roll. And so there's a toilet full of toilet paper. I see a little doo-doo on the toilet, on the toilet. I see some doo-doo on the carpet. I see Isaiah, there was some pants. It was her brother's pants. I don't even know how doo-doo got on her brother's pants. But it was like a big pile of doo-doo on her brother's pants. And I'm like, really? And Deja has taken off her pants. She's taken off her pull-up, and she has tried to clean herself up. And this child is in her room playing with toys. And not realizing that the stench of her mess is all over the house. Not realizing that everybody can tell you done did something. But no, she tried her best to clean it up. See, she tried her best. No, she had to use the whole roll of toilet paper to clean this thing up. Now, even though there is a pile of doo-doo in the corner, I cannot make this up. I cannot. I promise you, this happened yesterday. And pile of doo-doo in the corner. This child is chilling in her room playing with Doc McStuffin toys. And I said, Deja, come here. She took off her diaper. She has on some panties. And she's just walking around like, I'm good. I'm cleaned up. And I'm like, oh, no, you're not good. There's doo-doo all over the house. And the stench of your mess is all over the house, right? And how often do we mess up? And what we do is we try to run in the bathroom and we may have left the evidence all over the place. But we did a pretty good job of making ourselves feel more comfortable. We've done a pretty good job of cleaning up what we think we've done, and we think that we can keep on going. Not realizing that the stench of our mess has filled the house. Not realizing that the stench of our mess, it's come up to God's nostrils. Not realizing that the stench of our mess is everywhere. Not realizing that our mess is everywhere. And it doesn't just affect us, it affects everybody in the house. I'm telling you, we all need grace for today. When I look at my daughter, and you know, she's so fun-loving, like, yes, mommy, she come to me all innocent-like. And we often walk to Jesus' presence all innocent-like. Like, oh, Jesus, that was them. We walk and we come all innocent, like, oh, you, but I don't have a doo-doo diaper on now. And how often we come to Jesus and we have this, we just act like it's all right. It's together. This quarter, we're studying this book on the heart of the matter. And you know, one of the subjects that church just hates to talk about is sex. And the other subject that church hates to talk about is money. Stay out my bedroom and stay out my wallet. But yet, Jesus is looking at us and he smells it. And it's not just for the singles who are still struggling. It's not just for, you know, our teenagers. I mean, we love to tell them to wait till marriage. No, it's for all of us. The word says that if you look at a woman with lust in your heart, you have already committed adultery. Yeah, so all that porn is adultery. Some of those movies we watch, and that's adultery. And so often, even as we listen to the world around us and it tells us, no, who you are is just fine. I mean, a point comes where we're going to have to decide, yes, Jesus, you're right and I'm wrong. What happens when we have to look at the way we're feeling and, no, Jesus, you're right and my hormones are wrong. And even if I was born this way, Jesus, you're right. And the way I was born is wrong. What if we have to look at ourselves and say, yes, God, I am everything they say I am. God, I'm everything that your word says I am. God, I've messed up. God, this handwriting that is against me, this list is correct. And I'm so glad that the word says that the handwriting of ordinances that were against you, that list of things that is wrong with you, he nailed it to the cross. That things, all those things that is wrong with you, he said, I will take your punishment. All the things you, let me help you understand. See, there's a world that is telling us that if it feels good, do it. And if this is the way you feel like you've always been, go ahead. That's fine. I'm telling you, if you say that you have no sin, there is no sacrifice for your sin. So seriously, I like gay people. I like lesbian people. I treat everybody pretty much the same. I treat people the same, right? But this is the lie that it's not a sin. This lie that this is the way I was born. This is what, yes, you may be born like that. I'm not knocking that. But are you going to choose to love pleasure or are you going to choose to love God? And that's not just for gays and lesbians. That's for heterosexuals, too. We wouldn't have, you know, the license that homosexual immorality has, it was given because of heterosexual immorality. And so we have to look and say, God, you're right. Our culture calls God wrong. And so, if the culture says that God is wrong, who will you believe? And I think it becomes a choice. It becomes a choice even in our finances. All those greedy people in church. I'm not getting rich off of you. Y'all see how much money I make? It is on the annual report every year. I am not getting rich off of y'all. The truth has set us all free. Hallelujah. But the truth of the matter is, in everything that we do, we've got to decide that God is right. Even if that means I'm wrong. And if I am wrong, guess what? There's grace for today. He's got grace for us today. My appeal is simple. Choose grace for today. We don't walk around and act like we have no sin. Jesus' final words to the woman was, go and sin no more. Go and sin no more. He sent her accusers away. They left being convicted that she's no better than me. We're no better than each other. This is a struggle that we all have, that we gotta fight together. And we're gonna receive today's grace. Because Jesus has grace for wherever we are. I mean, whether you've been walking in celibacy and you are doing a thing, or whether you messed up last night and have plans for tonight, God has grace, not just to deliver you in your sin, but grace to deliver you from your sin. There is grace. There is a sacrifice for today.